Yes. So we've got a great fireside chat here, bringing tech world business sense to the energy transition. And so I would like to welcome up our panelists here. We've got TJ Harper, president at Armada Power, and Scott Bolton, senior vice president of transmission development at PacifiCorp. Please welcome our panelists. Well, thank you, gentlemen, both for joining me. Let's just start with some introduction. TJ, why don't you tell us a little bit about what Armada Power does?
Sure. Good afternoon. Good morning, I guess. So, according to Maria, we get shift done. So, that was perfectly set up. So, what Armada Power is doing is we're bringing hardware and software to the market. A management controller will sit on top of an electric water heater, and you saw in Maria's charts how much that electric water heater is a pull on the energy. And so we make that into thermal storage. And with the patent material IP that we have, we're able to go in there with our software and make millisecond decisions on energy, and we're able to shift the load. That puts us right in the value stack of being able to work on things like DR or cold load pickup. We have to find Maria after this and talk to her a little bit about EV charging, because we can apply that same technology there. That's what Armada Power does.
And Scott, why don't you tell us a little bit about PacifiCorp?
You bet. Thanks. So PacifiCorp is an electric utility. We're based out of Portland, Oregon. We serve six states across the West. We serve Oregon, Washington, California as Pacific Power under that retail brand, and Utah, Wyoming, and Idaho under Rocky Mountain Power as our brand on the east side of our system. We're part of the Berkshire Hathaway Energy family of businesses, and I guess my role here is to bring the cognitive dissonance of a utility bringing tech world savvy to anything. So, thanks.
Yeah, let's start there. So TJ, you know, why did Armada see an opening in the energy space? Why energy?
Well, I think it brings in, it's kind of where technology meets opportunity. And so the technology that we had was born out of Battelle, and we refined it over the last couple of years. And now what we're seeing, my first career was in telephony. And as we brought technology into telephony, it again was opportunity meeting technology. We were able to take Argentina and put them up on a wireless infrastructure within months. That's what's happening here. Energy is seeing innovation. The path of technology is coming together. And so just as, you know, we use it to a fault, but we use Amazon and we use Uber. We've been running around in taxis forever, right? And we've been buying forever. Many of my daughters have been buying forever. And so they just brought technology to an opportunity that has just created a renaissance. What we're doing right now is that same type of innovation and what we're bringing in here, because it starts with the water heater, but what we're able to do is be able to take that technology pretty much across the portfolio.
Yeah, so Scott, where are some of the biggest areas that tech is impacting the grid right now?
Yeah, it's the entirety of the grid. So if you think of the grid, the electric grid, as you know, one of the world's greatest machines. And when you really boil it down, it is a machine. It's a machine that was based on some pretty fundamental principles of, you know, engineering and physics that, you know, for its first 100 years, 150 years of lifespan, hasn't had a ton of the kinds of dynamic technologies that we're starting to see and experience today. And so we're really at the point of best trying to integrate, really driven by customers, but also through operational needs, new applications, new technologies, new infrastructure that we have to manage, and we have to think through how that overlays and how we bolt on that new technology into the existing machinery. I would say that dynamic is probably, you know, it touches every aspect of providing energy and operating the grid today, whether that's reliability, whether that's the growth and the additional electrification that we're seeing or decarbonization. But it all comes back to how do we assess, how do we adapt, how do we integrate new technology, and then how do we explore how we invest around an ever accelerating technology life cycle.
Yeah, that makes sense. And there's like, yeah, the human aspect that you sort of touched on, where it's like, you know, it's not just about the technology. It's about having it incorporated in a machine that is run by people. So, as a quick follow up, I guess I wanted to get a little more specific in terms of what are some areas, what are opportunities that have been presented in energy that only exist because of how tech is impacting the grid.
Yeah, and it's really throughout the entire, you know, machine, if you will. I think I would really, you know, to kind of ladder on some of the earlier conversations today, I think I would focus more on the customer interface end, where we're experiencing a different expectation, a different kind of customer who wants to be more engaged, more involved in their energy use, and frankly, their interaction, you know, with the grid, with the machine. So utilities, historically, you know, customers only hear from us when their bill's due or if the power's out. You know, the amount of engagement and the types of expectations have really, you know, blossomed into new areas that traditionally our sector hasn't experienced.
Yeah, I mean, and the sector is just rapidly evolving. TJ, when it comes to those expectations, you know, a lot's changed since the last time we had an in-person conference to talk about these sorts of things. So, you know, how have the past few years sort of changed your priorities and the priorities of your customers?
Yeah, so, I mean, we're dealing with everything that everybody else is dealing with people working from home, being able to find labor, the supply chain, and so on and so forth. But what we're finding, and I'll build on Scott's point, is that people are coming back from this chapter in our life with priorities and focus. And they are caring about their energy. It's not about flipping on the switch and, hey, it works now. It's about where is that coming from? What does that mean? And we're just finding more people engaged. So, you know, the Great Resignation is nothing more than people coming back and saying, hey, I took inventory of my life, and this is where I want to take it. What we're finding right now is customers are coming forward and they're saying, I need to learn about this energy. I hear a lot about this energy. It dominates the news. And what can I do to be a part of it? So we are seeing that a lot in the industry. And that's where our technology comes in to help.
Yeah, so you intersect with the demands of the new energy customer a lot, because you're talking about thermal storage and DR, EV charging. Those increased customer demands are changing your priorities. But also, how are utilities... What are they coming to you in terms of, like, hey, you know, our projects have completely changed because of XYZ. What does that mean for your business?
Yeah, I mean, it's become a big challenge, I think, to how we run our business and the mindset behind our business, because, you know, conferences like this, we're talking about that customer that's highly engaged. And I would still say it's still probably a minority of customers. So that's maybe one bucket of customer. You then have another bucket of customer that's more passive, but at least accepting of change in the new technologies and opportunities and engagement strategies we may be employing. And that's probably the middle and probably the largest segment of customers. And then you got the customers that are kind of anti-engagement. You know, we just went through a smart meter rollout a few years ago, and you know, having some of our installers, you know, kind of run off people's properties with shotguns was not as uncommon as I would hope. And so the spectrum of customer engagement and expectation has really broadened, I'd say, over the last 10 or 15 years. And that's really presented some challenges and I think opportunities as well, but has really forced a rethinking in how we deliver our business, because the you know, that expectation range has gone beyond a very traditional mindset where, you know, you provide non-discriminatory, everybody gets access service at a pretty stable rate. And as long as it's not, you know, too unstable and it's not too high, people are generally happy. And those happiness metrics have become much more granular and have changed dramatically from under us. So technology presents a huge opportunity to re-engage and meet those expectations and offer those services or those experiences that those customers that are highly engaged really desire. They're also, I wouldn't say a threat, but they are a unique challenge for us as well, because as we cater to that bucket of customers, we've got to figure out ways to bring the rest of those customers along as we incorporate these changes.
Dylan, what I would add to that, kind of being a supplier to the utilities, we're just trying to help those utilities manage those mandates, manage those regulatory, manage those customer expectations, and providing the technology to help them get to those points. So in our case, you know, there's a lot of money coming out through the infrastructure bills, right? And so we're working together with utilities to be able to bring our technology in there to help them be able to get a hold of that money and be able to deliver that to their customer and to their market.
Yeah, that makes sense. I was just curious, as sort of an add-on to that, you know, because we're talking about Tech World, Business Sense, and the energy transition. So what's a way that a utility could maybe better understand their customer base and their power market? Like what's something that maybe is a blind spot for them?
Oof. Well, you know, in some ways, there's a lot of different ways to answer that, but maybe I'll draw from something that I heard earlier that resonated with me, and it was Jared's equity discussion, where he challenged folks who are leaders in the energy space to be radical, to seek out change and to challenge paradigms. That is extremely radical for a utility. You know, TJ just touched on another note, which is, you know, the vendors, the partners that we have in assessing and adopting new technologies, the ones who are the most successful are the ones who understand and embrace the regulatory paradigm that utilities operate within. And it's hard to break from that. And I'm not sure if we want to break from that, to be honest. I think, you know, regulation absolutely has its place when you're providing essential service, and there's not as much, you know, choice as you have for other services in your life. At the same time, that regulation can be very constraining. And I think that in a world where technology is coming at us more rapidly, and again, you know, I want to really underscore the life cycle of technology. If you look at Moore's Law, and you know that each advancement, each generational advancement in technology will become shorter and more powerful, that means you're changing out equipment, you're changing out systems, how you deploy capital into your business, how you make the investments that will ultimately be borne by those consumers that you're being regulated to protect, is going to change pretty dramatically, and that will also shape, I think, the customer's expectations and experience.
Yeah, I think education's a big part as well. right? So I think you have a client base right now that is really reaching out and saying, hey, teach me about this, because this is a complex ecosystem, right? So I think a part of getting that engagement and getting that is to get out there and educate. And that's one of the things that we're doing throughout our organization, is trying to get out, talk to people, and let them learn. Energy is a complex space. And once they learn about it and they can see how technology such as what we have at Armada can shift a load, and we can bring the renewables in, and they're starting to resonate with that, then I think that's where you're really going to influence the experience.
Yeah, I think that's really true, especially in the context of the ecosystem that you were talking about, Scott, where it's where you've got a more educated customer base, and then they can sort of better understand that, then we can start looking at like those changes in the way that we do it, the changes in regulation, because then there will be public pressures more educated regulators, and then that can sort of shift in that direction. Plus, it also helps them more clearly ask the utility for specifically what it is that they want. So that makes sense on how it's better for the end user.
I was just gonna say I love that answer, and I think it's something that I think is a really critical component to any company that is going to be a partner or do business with the utility, is to bring that education and to bring that customer insight component. We're not great marketers. I don't go around saying, what's it going to take to get you in this electricity today? It's a product that sells itself, and people have grown up with. It's not really new to anybody. But how you use it and your engagement with it, whether it's for, cost purposes, because we're moving to time-of-use structures, or we're trying to create demand response opportunities, or for transportation, that's what's really changing, and we need help, and we're looking for help, and we'll appreciate that help when we see it.
One thing that might be tricky about that, though, is maybe this is a trap of a question, but can you calculate ROI for investing in a community? Can you do that as a utility?
I personally think you can, because then it's adoption, right? So with the Armada Power solution, we're going to have to get into the home to get to the water heater and so forth. So when you start talking about education and you calm the nerves of what's going on, then I think adoption comes from that. And then you can adopt to programs, and then you're going to be able to get into the home, and you're going to have better participation in your programs and so forth. So I think it's the linchpin.
So one thing I wanted to ask you about, TJ, since you were talking about your supplier for the utilities, and we were talking about how things have been changing. One thing that's been brought up a lot, especially with how COVID affected global commerce, was the supply chain. How has that affected Armada, and just how has that affected utilities' long-term plans as well?
Yeah, this one's tough. So I've been around for a while, and I lived through the tantalum capacitor worldwide shortage, the rubidium oscillator worldwide shortage. That was one part. in our solution, we're chasing parts every single day right now. And so, obviously, a lot of economic factors, a lot of geopolitical factors factor into that. But the big challenge I have right now is it is every element of my supply chain. It's not just a worldwide allocation of a certain commodity. It's the entire thing. So, again, education and communication is a big element here. We're having to go to our customer base and tell them, look, here's the solution. Here's what it's going to do. Here, because the time's now. To get solutions into the market, because the market's ready for it. It's the whole technology meets the opportunity. And what we're doing is we're telling them, commit, And by creating that backlog and creating that demand, we're having more influence into the supply chain, because we're not just competing with our industry. We're we're competing with the world. And it's very difficult for us right now. But we're starting to see signs of it coming back. So that's good to see. It's just, I think we just have to keep the persistent pressure applied to the supply chain.
Yeah, I mean, we're a sector that's dominated by engineers and accountants. So we're in a constant search for optimization. That is probably the, you know, one of the most lizard brain functions of a utility system. And so these are all constraints. These are all, you know, barriers or headwinds to that optimization, whether it's supply chain, whether it's, frankly, the integration of new systems and technologies. You know, you can have the most whiz-bang new functionality brought to your business, your enterprise, and realize that, you know, you've created a domino effect of other needs that you didn't really anticipate. We recently upgraded our resource planning model, brought in a great new system to get more granularity, to get more data, use that data more effectively. Again, trying to seek out optimization as the, you know, the meadow in the clearing, and realize that we lacked the computing power to truly use this system, and it had some knock-on investment effects that we had to go pursue. And I would also say, you know, just the expansion and the amount of new technology adoption and integration challenges also presents, I think, those customer experience opportunities, which I've heard a lot about this morning, and I think are, you know, wonderful ways to engage. But each point of contact becomes a new risk as well when you think about cybersecurity and physical security. And so all of these things have to kind of balance out within the ecosystem that we're operating in.
So what would your advice be to help navigate some of these barriers and challenges?
You know, I think no two systems are exactly alike, no two companies, no two enterprises, utilities. I think, you know, one of the things that I've always found a little surprising, a little vexing, is that a lot of people work in energy don't always understand energy policy or the energy landscape, how utilities are regulated, or even the topology of the utility. So there are some solutions that may work great, say, you know, here in Austin, but, you know, we serve communities across Wyoming, which has almost half of the population within the city limits here, and is the size of all of West Texas. And so, you know, a solution in a place like, you know, Central or Western Wyoming may look very different for us than a place like Northeast Portland or the Salt Lake Valley. So, you know, where I found the folks who have been the most successful working with us are those that really understand where we're coming from and what, you know, our landscape looks like, both economically as well as demographically and geographically.
I think that one thing that you need to be able to do is really look at the landscape and kind of check the old baggage. And so check some of the assumptions that are inside of the ecosystem and be able to go there and say, like, for example, what we get a lot is, oh, well, this is just the water heater, you're switching it on and off. No, this is new technology. Don't go back to those old chapters. Come back to it and say, look, we're actually getting shift done, and we're able to move that, and we're providing that path to bring the renewables in. We're just doing a lot of different things. So my big thing is, you know, with the title that we have for this session is check the old baggage, see how the technology can come in, and make sure it can apply to your business. Because really, your technology is doing nothing more than running your business model and the processes you have within the walls. So you just got to be able to make that work for you, but not really go with the system and redesign it. Make that technology work for you, and obviously check the old baggage.
And don't be afraid.
Yeah.
Okay, so we've got just under 5 minutes left. Bethany, have any questions come in from Slido?
We sure did. The first question, what is one thing you believe specifically about the utility space that no one else believes?
You got this one.
Yeah, I was going to say, I didn't expect a very existential question.
Wow.
What do I believe? I mean, here's what I believe. I believe that no other business model has been as successful in America and in being inclusive and not leaving people behind. You know, we don't have universal healthcare, but we have near universal access to electricity. And that's, you know, that's a great success story from the beginnings of rural electrification to now where we're talking about, you know, crossing barriers from traditional uses of electrification to, you know, now basing our transportation system largely on electrification to using electrification as a primary tool for decarbonization and getting into other sectors of the economy to try to drive down, you know, the emissions that contribute to climate change. And so the fundamental model, while it's sometimes been unwieldy and God knows very Byzantine from a legal and regulatory perspective, I think has delivered on that promise of inclusivity and bringing community along, which does go back to that ROI because, you know, we are where we serve. We're not going to pick up and move to a more lucrative market. You kind of are where you are, and you're vested in that community's success and prosperity.
I think the key thing is for what people don't know, I think, is that innovation's coming, and it's coming in this industry. Maria's slides were telling, right, in terms of how people are thinking about EV. Everybody's thinking about the cars and everything that goes with that, but they're not thinking about how does that energy get to that car. So I think we should be part of an energy transition, an energy renaissance, and we should really be looking at technology and having the next Uber or Amazon come out of the energy industry. I think that's what the Thought Summit's about, and we need to be finding those solutions.
Yeah, and you know, one thing I'll just say to wrap us up here is that I think not only does tech pose a great opportunity for the energy industry, I think the energy industry also provides opportunities to get ordinary people more focused on how technology can affect these like universal systems, and then we can end up with like then we get that feedback loop and that ecosystem that can just create better solutions and better systems for everybody. We've only got a minute left, so it's not really enough time to get another question. But just any parting words?
Thank goodness.
any parting words?
No, I just think technology and innovations where and opportunity that's we're at that crossroad right now. So I think we need to embrace it. We need to bring it into our ecosystem, and really deliver the customer experience that we have talked about. Educate people about what we're doing, and I think we would see far more greater adoption from our communities.
All right. Well, thank you both for joining me on this panel today. It's been great. Thank you all. I hope you enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, there will be one more panel before lunch. And while we're getting...